We've been in a sermon series titled All In, Living with Full Throttle Faith. And today, I'm going to be closing up this sermon series. This will be the final sermon in this sermon series. And quite frankly, there were two or three more topics that I wanted to address, but I just really sense it's time to wrap it up. I will address those topics later, probably first part of January, in standalone sermons, because there are a couple more things that I think are just really important if we're going to be all in with our faith. One of those being discipleship. Discipleship is so important. In a word, what that means is you need to be taught and trained, and you need, at some point, as you mature in your faith, you also need to be teaching someone else or others. So there should always be someone we're learning from and someone who's learning from us, I'll expand on that in the future. But it's very important. You want to do it God's way, and you want to be successful in your Christian living. You need to be all in on discipleship. I planned on doing a sermon on the importance of the church, like the gathering of the church and the realization that the church is called the bride of Christ. And if we're going to love what Jesus loves, that means we've got to love each other. The importance of gathering together and the danger of living in a culture where we can kind of be deceived into thinking that we are part of something by simply watching something on a TV screen. I am really grateful for the technology we have, but it can be abused. And at times, we can be disconnected from the church and kind of have a false sense of connection because of media. And there's a very important purpose in God telling us to gather together. And I had planned on trying to put that into the sermon series as well. All that to say, we're shutting it down this morning. This is the final sermon in the sermon series. As we start to think about the holiday season, I've got some things on Christmas that I want to be moving towards in the next couple of weeks. And so the sermon this morning is on love. And from the beginning of the sermon series, this has always been what was going to be the final sermon. It is what I call the grand finale of the things we must be all in when we talk about being all in for Jesus. There is few things, if any, I actually believe there are none, more important than understanding the power of love. I think it is the most important aspect of our Christian faith. And if you'll give me a few minutes this morning, I'll expand on that and explain why I believe that. You know, ultimately, this entire sermon series, in a word, is about impact. How do we impact our families, our neighbors, our community? How does the church have an impact? And the short answer is by being all in with our faith. You know, when you study the history of the church, what you'll find is that the people who make the greatest impact, the first century church, when you look at the great awakenings of the church history, it is always by a pocket of people who are just all in. It's never the half-hearted. It's never a group of people who are just kind of walking through their faith and all of a sudden stumbled upon this great transformation in their culture. It's a people that were all in, committed to prayer, seeking the face of God, in tune to what was going on in their world, asking God to move, being willing to be agents of change. It's about impact. And the things that we've studied so far will play a role in helping us have a great impact. I promise you this. You get committed to prayer. We talked about prayer was one of our things, being all in on prayer. You get all in on prayer where you are dedicated to praying, dedicating to seeking the face of God, dedicated on a regular basis to talking to God about the things that need to happen in your life and in your circle of influence. I promise you this. You will find that your impact in those areas starts to go up. One of the things was knowing God. You be all in and commit yourself to knowing him and seeking him and learning to decipher his voice in your life. you'll find that your impact goes up. These things are ultimately about helping us to be all in, living with full throttle faith, so that we have the greatest impact that we can have with the lives that God has given us. I don't believe there's a single topic that's more important than love when it comes to our ability to have a maximum impact in our culture. It is the most important. And I want us to examine why together today. I'm going to give you three reasons that love is the greatest of all Christian attributes. Number one, love is more powerful than evil. Love is more powerful than evil. When we understand the power of love, it will change the way we look at our mission here on earth. Now, this one point I've been meditating on for weeks because I don't know how to explain it really well. I'm going to do the best I can here in a moment, but I'm going to tell you that I've spent hours, plural, looking for ways to illustrate the point I'm going to try to illustrate. I've looked for hours trying to find pictures or images that would help me communicate what I want to communicate, and I just couldn't find it. When I talk about the power of love being greater than the power of evil, I am referencing the reality that we do live in a spiritual battle, that there is a war against God, against the Word, against truth. It's real. And the only way that we overcome evil is through the power of love. But what you'll find is that we as Christians, we often get frustrated. We get frustrated when we look around and we see wickedness taking place and we see horrible things happening. And what we as people and as Christians are often prone to do is to get exhausted and decide the easiest way to fight evil is just to become like them. And so if they're going to scream and they're going to be angry and they're going to be mad and they're going to be hurtful, then we're going to scream louder and we're going to be more mad and we're going to push them back. And I've seen Christians do it, become so frustrated with what is evil that they almost, it's like at some point, I've been patient long enough. I've been gracious long enough. This being nice isn't working. This being loving isn't working. And so the only way that we can see change happen is if we fight fire with fire, we get down in the mud and we pick up mud and we start throwing mud too. And I've seen it happen. I've seen it happen with Christians who sincerely are just fed up with evil, that get out of God's way of doing things and sort of start fighting fire with fire, and it doesn't work. And what I want you to see is that love is more powerful than evil. As I was meditating on this over the last several weeks, there was one event in history that really kept coming to the forefront of my mind. And so I want us to look at that event together. This is the moment that it was officially decided Jesus would die. There was a lot that led to the moment, a whole lot of anger and hatred that led to this moment, but this was the moment that it happened. And what we're going to see in this text as we read it, we're going to see the government there. We're going to see the religious leaders there. We're going to see the community there, and we're going to see all of them together, angry and hateful and conspiring together to kill an innocent man. I want us to look at it. You'll find this in Matthew chapter 27. Beginning in verse 15, here's the event. It says, "Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted, and they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, 'Whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Barabbas?'" Christ. I'm going to pause and just explain something for those that aren't familiar with this story. Once a year, to give the false impression of being gracious, the Roman governor would allow the Jewish people to request one person who would be pardoned. That person would be released. At this moment, Jesus has been arrested, and the Jewish people are calling for his death. Pilate has examined him, doesn't find him guilty of anything, realizes that the people just hate Jesus, and Pilate's thinking to himself, I don't really want to kill this guy if I don't have to. And so he's got a trick up his sleeve. I'm going to force them right now to choose which prisoner I pardon. And I'm going to bring out the most vile, horrendous person, and I'm going to tell them they got two choices. Either you can release this guy or you can release Jesus. Pilate thought to himself, there's no way the crowd is going to let this notorious murderer loose. So that's what's going on here. So he says, whom do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ? For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream. Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? And they said, Barabbas. Pilate said to them, then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ? They all said, let him be crucified. And he said, why? What evil has he done? But they shouted all the more, let him be crucified. So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves. And all the people answered, his blood be on us and on our children. Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. I want you to just for a moment try to visualize this scene, if it's possible. I want you to visualize probably thousands, at least 1,000 is a big group of people, all there. Jesus' disciples have abandoned him. And I want you to try to see the collective hatred that is being hurled at Jesus. You've got Rome, and the way the soldiers treat him is horrendous, as if you will read on. You got Pilate thinking that he can just wash his hands. You can't just wash your hands of Jesus. Pilate was literally the one guy who had the power to simply say, no, this isn't going to happen. He doesn't get to stand up there and wash his hands. You've got Rome. You've got the earthly religious leaders of the day. You've got the community. You've got the church and multitudes of Jewish believers there, all together, filled with hatred, calling for the murder of an innocent man. It's an absolutely horrendous picture. It's about as evil of any given moment you will ever find. It tells us they were shouting. Just try to imagine. Just humor me for a moment and try to imagine how loud do you think it was? A crowd that size, everybody shouting. Whatever was going on, they were so clearly enraged that the governor just knew, he had an instinct, there's no stopping this. The level of hatred, the level of evil right now has risen to a point, there is no stopping it, there is no way to deter it. We're just going to have to go through with this and murder an innocent man. That's the only way to move forward here. Imagine the atmosphere. who shouts, his blood be on us and our children? Who says that? And how do you get an entire crowd to be chanting that? In addition to the earthly forces that were there, you have the supernatural forces of Satan and all of the demonic realm playing a significant role in the crowd and whipping the crowd up. And so you have all of these people who have come together for one purpose, and that is to stop the plan of God. That's it. And I want you to picture it. There, all by himself, alone, none of his disciples beside him, there stands one man, just one, against it all. And you know what would force him to keep moving forward? Love. It's a mind-blowing thought. Literally love for the very people who would kill him. And while all of them thought that they were stopping Jesus, the love that he had for them, the love that he had for the Father, would drive him on forward, and he literally would win. Love always wins in the end. We know how the story ends. It's true that Jesus laid down his life, but Jesus said, nobody takes my life from me. I willingly lay it down. The Bible teaches us that Jesus could have called thousands, tens of thousands of angels to come and get him off of that cross. It's not that evil won, it's that love said, I will endure what seems unendurable because of the love that I have for people. There is a power in love that is greater than the power of evil. And brothers and sisters, we must understand this to be agents of change in our culture, in our community, and in our families. Because all of us are prone at times when things get hard and we see evil and we see wickedness and it seems like we're not getting anywhere. We're like, just call the angels in. These people deserve to be destroyed. But love made one man stand against all the greatest display of evil that we've ever seen and absolutely triumph over it because there is a power that love has to destroy evil. Jesus never stopped. There, standing against the greatest compilation of hate in the history of the world, the love of one man would overcome it all. In the end, love wins. It always does. We have to trust this as God's people. If we're going to be all in for God, all in, full throttle faith, holding nothing back, agents of change, we must be people of love, and we must trust the power of love. Number two, love is the chief characteristic of God's kingdom. You might call it the defining characteristic of God's kingdom. Satan's entire kingdom is built upon hatred, fear, and lies. It's the opposite of God's kingdom, which is built on love, trust, and truth. And if we're going to belong in God's kingdom, we're going to take our rightful place in God's kingdom, we have to understand the chief characteristic is love. If we're going to be like our God, then we must be a people of love. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, there's this interesting statement about God where it says that God is love. It's a really short statement about God that's worth memorizing. God is love. You know, the Bible teaches us that God is gracious, but it doesn't say that he is grace. It teaches us that God is merciful, but it doesn't say he is mercy. However, it says he is love. I'm going to tell you why I believe that is. It's as if love is really the trunk. Love is the source of it all. And when the tree is right, when the tree is love, the branches that come out follow. The branch of grace, the branch of mercy, the branch of patience, the branch of forgiveness. Those things flow from love. And God is love. It is His very nature. Love is defined in what God is. When it comes to love, the Bible says God is love. This is the defining characteristic of God. It is the defining characteristic of His kingdom. Look at something Jesus says that's just really powerful. It says Jesus is near the end of His ministry, and somebody comes to Him to talk to Him, and here's what it says. One of them, a lawyer, asked Him a question to test Him. Teacher, what is the greatest or the great commandment in the law? And He said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Look at these two things Jesus said. He said, you shall love the Lord, you shall love your neighbor. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Leave that slide up for just a moment. I'll let you know when to bring it down. So just a little bit about what's going on right here. It says one of the teachers of the law came and asked what the great commandment was. So you might call them the scholars of the day, would often sit around and talk about what's the greatest law. There were hundreds of them. And so sometimes it was just like a fun topic. And then, is this law the same as this? Are they connected? Which one's more important? And the text seems to indicate that Jesus is dealing with a sincere question, because there's no rebuke here. There's no indication that they were trying to catch Him up. It's like a sincere question, and Jesus gives this answer about the law. It's a reference to the Old Testament. He said, love the Lord, love your neighbor. On these two commandments depends all the law and the prophets. First of all the law and all the prophets. If you don't know what that means, let me quickly explain. It's just really a reference to the Old Testament as a whole. Those were the two major divisions that people thought of when they thought of the Bible. The law being the portion of the Bible where the history and the laws of God are written out. And then the prophets being the individual books that the prophets wrote. And so it's just a reference to the known Bible of the day. And look what Jesus says about it. All of it. That's an awesome thought. All of it is kept in these two commandments. Love the Lord. Love your neighbor. All right, you can take that down. Consider the simplicity of that. All the laws, all the writings of the prophets, basically the entire Word of God is kept in keeping these two simple statements. This is why I say it's love is like the tree of which all other branches grow out of. If we get this thing right, if we love God correctly and we love people correctly, everything else flows out of that. That is a really awesome thought. It's the chief characteristic of God's kingdom. The third reason that love, I believe, is the most important of all the characteristics of the Christian life is because love is not complicated. Love is not complicated. Now, I'm not saying that it's, you know, easy to love God with all your heart, soul, and strength. What I'm saying is it's not complicated to understand that command. I'm not saying that it's easy to love everybody in your life. What I'm saying is it's not complicated to understand what that means. There are some things that can be complicated in the Christian life. But the major thing God's called us to do is not complicated at all. Love God, love people. You know, we are a church that for the most part is a pretty Bible-educated church. You come here long enough, you're actually going to hear the Bible read. You're going to hear it explained. And over time, you're going to be able to say, I know more about the Bible as a result of being here. And so we do have a pretty solid, biblically educated church. Yet with most of you, maybe not most, but with a good portion of you, if I was to ask you to explain the difference between salvation, sanctification, and glorification and the process in which those occur, you would not be real certain that you wanted to stand up and give that a go right now. There's some of you that are like, what are those words? I thought you said no speaking in tongues 2 weeks ago. Those are real words. They have meanings. And they're important to our faith. But the point that I'm making is, when we talk about the major thing that God's called us to, it is so simple. It's just love. Like, love God, love people. It is simple. It's to me, it's absolutely incredible that God, who is complicated beyond our ability to even, we're like ants compared to God. God, who is capable of thinking up the universe. God, who is capable of forming the earth and making it rotate perfectly around the sun at the perfect distance for human life, for taking the dirt from this earth and forming us out of it, breathing into us life, like all the things that God does, so mind-blowing. And yet, when he made his design for you and I, it was so simple as love God, love people. Only God could come up with something so incredibly simple for us. And so if we learn to focus on this, it changes everything. You want to be a great Christian? Become great at loving God and loving people. It's that easy. Isn't that awesome how simple it is? It's not complicated. And then not only is the concept not complicated, putting it into practice is not that complicated. There's only two ways you can love people, in word and in deed. That's it. Love people with the way you speak and love people with your actions. That's so simple. Consider first loving in word. You know, God loved us by giving us his word. You open this thing and you read it, you can open up just about any book in this entire Bible and quickly, you don't have to read very far, quickly come to the truth that God loves us. That God is a God of love. God tells us that he loves us. We need to be people who use our words to love others well. Proverbs 16:24 says, gracious words are like honeycomb, sweetness to the soul, and health to the body. Isn't that an awesome thought that when we have gracious words, loving words, that it's like honeycomb, sweetness to the soul, health to the body? We need to be using our words to build people up, and we need to be using our words especially to communicate love to the people that we love. If you want to love someone, the way you speak to them is crucial. Men, we tend to do a much more poor job of this than the ladies. Men in general use less words than ladies, according to somebody's research. I mean, don't quote me on it. But it is true that we tend to have a harder time communicating love. And all I want to tell you is, man, if we're going to be more like our God, we've got to learn to use our words to communicate love, because he didn't hold back. Jesus spoke about love to his disciples. He told his disciples, this is how the whole world's going to even know that you follow me, is that you have love for one another. Like, greater love has no one than this. And he laid down his life for his friends. And like, Jesus was just all in at letting his disciples know, I love you. I'm going to demonstrate my love for you. I'm going to lay down my life for you because I love you. And so we got to get it out of our mind and out of our heart that somehow letting people know we love them isn't manly. Look what Proverbs 27:5 says. Better is open rebuke than hidden love. Better is open rebuke than hidden love. Who likes to be rebuked publicly? Nobody. Is there anybody here that likes to be rebuked publicly? If so, put a hand up. And I'll rebuke you publicly for lying in church. Nobody likes to be rebuked openly. It's embarrassing. It's hurtful. And yet, according to God, he says that's better than hidden love. In other words, love that's not expressed. Love is meant to be expressed. Love is meant to be communicated. And so we've got to learn to use our words to communicate love and to express love, because it's not good to hide it and to keep it a secret. So speak words of kindness, speak words of love, build people up with your words. And second, let us consider what it looks like to love in action, or to love in deed. 1 John chapter 3, it says, "By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth." So that last little statement there, let us not love in word or talk, that's certainly not saying that we shouldn't use our words to communicate love. The message there is that it has to go beyond words. If you really love somebody, you need to communicate that, but there should be actions that follow that. Don't just say you love people. Don't just say you love God. Don't just say you love folks and then do nothing about it. There should be actions that follow. We are to love in deed. Jesus demonstrated his love for us. In Romans 5:8, it says, God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And so we see that love needs to be put into action. The question is asked in the text that we just read in 1 John chapter 3. The question's asked, like, basically, if you see your brother in need, you have the ability to help him, and you shut your heart and do nothing about it, it's a rhetorical question, how could that be the love of God? The obvious answer is that's not the love of God. You look at how God loved us in our time of need. He went all in for us. You look at what Jesus did for us in our time of need while we were still sinners. He died for us. He gave all that you could possibly give so that we might be reconciled to God. And so the point being here that the love of God, it does something. It's not just words. It goes beyond words. It's into action. Now, here's the awesome thing when I think about the simplicity, when I say that love is not complicated, it's not difficult to understand. To me, it's just mind-blowingly simple. There's two people that we need to love, God and people, right? There's two categories. Love God with all your heart, love people as yourself. That's it. Those are the two categories. And then how do we do it? With our words and with our actions. That's amazing to me. And I promise you this, folks, if we can stay focused on those things and not get diverted, and learn to live with that mindset of, I'm going to love God with all of my heart today, and I'm going to love the people that come into my sphere of influence. You learn to live that way each day. I promise you this, you'll have maximum impact in your faith. This is love in action, that God died for us while we were yet sinners. I want to close with just looking at this slide that we looked at a minute ago. You shall love the Lord, and you shall love your neighbor. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Go ahead and leave that up for a moment. This book is more important than I could ever explain. Guys, this is the Word of God. This book is divine from beginning to end. It's a fascinating book. I'm actually going to be doing a study on the Word of God in the near future as well. You need to be in the book. You need to read the book. You need to know the book. This is the Bible tells us that the Word of God is living. It's different than any other book that's ever existed. It's alive. And so I want to qualify what I'm about to say with what I just said. This is important. But everything that's in here is kept. When we love God with all of our heart, soul, and strength, and we love our neighbor as ourselves, I don't know that it's possible to overexpress the importance of love. We've got to love. And if we're going to be great in our Christian walk, great for God, we've got to be great at loving God and great at loving people. We've got to guard our hearts from not overcomplicating the Christian faith. If we do these things well, everything else will follow. Love God with all you have. Love people. It's that simple. Now let's go do it, and let's do it with intentionality, and let's do it with passion. Amen.